With the help of my good friend here, we're going to talk about sternocleidomastoid because it's a very interesting muscle, and it's one of those things that I think gets a bit misunderstood, particularly when you look at the connections with it from a fascial perspective, how it joins up with other things. So the meaning of the word sternocleidomastoid is telling you where it goes from. So it goes from the sternum, we understand that, and then we have cleido or cleido, and cleido, forgive me, stelios, if you're watching, is a Greek word, and apparently everything's a Greek word according to stelios. So we have sterno and cleido, cleido is a Greek word meaning key, and key bone. So various languages have the word key for this bone. So the Schlauterbein in Dutch and the Schlüsselbein in German, and both those words mean key. So the key bone. I don't know why, I think it's supposed to look like some kind of skeleton key, I don't really understand. And from here what happens is it goes up, and it goes up with these two angles, and it goes up right the way up and attaches to the back edge of the mastoid process, so it's all round up into here. So if you feel behind your ear, back of that's a little styloid there, then it's attaching to this underside of the skull. Its job, if you follow the anatomy to its limit, is to always, you know, pull from insertion, so pulling origin towards insertion, or upwards the other way, so pull. So it's lateral flexion, so it's lateral flexion on the side, lateral flexion on the other side, and forward flexion when it's working bilaterally. There's a couple of really interesting things that join the sternocleidomastoid up in here. And one of them is the splenius capitis. So splenius is going to be sitting underneath this sternocleidomastoid and blending all the way down to the thoracic spine. We also have one of the erector spinae muscles going up into here. And we also have a little muscle that comes from the inside of the jaw that goes to the hyoid. And then goes backwards to the sternocleidomastoid. So you've got four structures attaching to this single point into here that are all going to be involved and associated with the movement of the head. Now, here's the other interesting thing. A few years ago, I was at a workshop with Tom Myers, he of anatomy trains fame, and he said that he felt that the sternocleidomastoid, he didn't feel, he stated it as a fact, went up to across the back of the head to through the lamboidal suture, this sort of bit of a bony bit, there's a little sort of stitch across there, and down around the other side to form a sling. And I thought, well, I wondered what this was, where this came from, and he suggested, well, it made sense. And so I thought, well, let's go and find out. So I took myself into an anatomy lab, as I can do, and I dissected a gentleman. And I discovered on him and subsequently that really the sternocleidomastoid blends much, much broader into the overarching shape of the scalp fascia, the galea aponeurotica. And so all I did was I just sort of took this literally peeled it away, and it came away without much in the way of cutting to reveal a continuous, continuity, if you like, of fascia over the head. And this gives it a slightly different implication in relation to when we think about function. So allow me to make a complete idiot of myself and demonstrate. So if I take my raggedy old scarf now, which is a bit the worse for wear, and I put this over my head like a sort of a shawl of an old lady, and I imagine that this is the sternocleidomastoid, and I take this and I draw this down behind my ears, and I... Okay, you can laugh if you want. And if you want to take screenshots and circulate them on social media, then here we go. And we're taking this. So what we've effectively got now is what I think of as the bowling ball effect. The bowling ball effect of imagine you've got a bowling ball in here, and you're doing this, that old bowling ball cleaning. Now the head is weighing, 10, 12, 14 pounds in some instances. And so what the sternocleidomastoid doing is creating with its fascia, creating a massive strength and continuity for the feeling of how that head is being pulled forward. If the head is being brought forward, we're going to see that there's a shortening. So that fascial continuity would then blend itself through the sternum and down into the, you know, down into the pelvis. You know, you could see a straight line almost through sternum and down into rectus abdominis from here. So you could get that forward flexion. So sternocleidomastoid massively involved in this forward flexion, but massively involved in that stabilization of the neck and head. I was skiing a few years ago and had a very benign fall. I was, you know, wasn't even going anywhere. It was foggy and the conditions were bad and I just slipped and I smacked the back of my head right onto here. And fortunate enough, I was wearing a helmet. About 48 hours later, I had what I could describe as a whiplash, where every single movement was incredibly painful. And it was really interesting. I was absolutely fascinated. I was getting my head off the pillow and going, oh. And I was noting down what felt, but I felt really strongly all the way through down into my collarbone, down into my sternum, and down into my rib cage, into my chest. The ability for me to breathe was really limited from this jar onto here. So it was quite an impactful thing. So sternocleidomastoid has a couple of also little landmarks into here. So on this forward part of it, if you sort of follow sternocleidomastoid down and you sort of dig around in that notch in there, you've got the jugular vein, and this will be the place that you'll also find the carotid artery and the vagus nerve. So there and then the phrenic nerve are going through there as well. And also you've got a lot of lymph nodes into here. You know, lymph nodes tend to hang around where there's lots of muscular contraction. Of course, one hopes that the head and the shoulder area would have lots of muscular contraction. So sternocleidomastoid, very interesting structure, joining up with several other bits of tissue to probably do something that we haven't really noted, other than just lateral flexion or forward flexion when it's working bilaterally. Joined up fascially with the front of the jaw and the hyoid bone, with the rest of the rectus spinae. So there we go, interesting muscle. And you know, watch this space for more. I could show my age by going, what do you think of the show so far? Rubbish. So thanks very much for watching, and not you. Thanks very much for watching, and please, any questions, comments, do the stuff you're supposed to do on social media, like and share it, tell other people about what I'm doing here. I'm in one of those funny moods today, so thank you very much, and it's always, I love getting the comments in the comments below, so please join in the conversation, share it as widely as you can, and see you next time.